And now, an 8 original production.
Books and Company is made possible by the Virginia G. Piper Center for Creative Writing, serving writers and readers in the Phoenix metropolitan area and throughout Arizona.
Welcome to Books and Company. Bienvenidos todos. I'm Alberto Rios, your host, and we're joined today by Carolyn O'Bagy Davis, author most recently of Hopi Summer, Letters from Ethel to Maud, which was the winner of the 2011 One Book Arizona Award, and is the story of an extended, though perhaps unlikely, correspondence between a Hopi woman and the mother of a family traveling from Massachusetts in the 1920s. The book is published by Rio Nuevo Publishers. Welcome, Carolyn.
Thank you very much for having me here tonight.
Well, I can't wait to talk about this book. So, first of all, I want to congratulate you on the One Book Arizona Award. Do you want to say just something about that?
Well, I am so honored to be part of One Book, and it's just a thrill. It's amazing. And one thing that I'm so pleased about is that I get to share this story with so many people and be part of all of the literacy efforts. Yeah. And speak to such a wide range of people, children and adults and all over.
It's wonderful.
It
and,
is.
And so it's a common book. Everybody reads the book or is encouraged to read the book mm-hmm. together. Mm-hmm. This is our news, isn't it? This is great news. This is Arizona news. I want to talk now just a little bit about how the book is basically structured, and then I'm going to let you say some things about it. It really falls into two parts, and the first one is the initial travel by the Melville family, who go all over the country, and then later the subsequent correspondence between mm-hmm. Mrs. Melville and Ethel
Mutchfa. It was difficult for me to reconcile because it really was two books. I write about the Hopi people, and this was what I first thought the book would be about. But as I learned more about this amazing trip from this family, this fairly wealthy intellectual family from Massachusetts, and they decided they were going to take this grand round-the-country trip in an old car. They'd never done anything like this. They'd never camped out. You think dirt roads, no bridges, no gas stations, no hotels.
This was like 1927, right?
It was such a rugged adventure for them. Mrs. Melville was a matron. She was a professor's wife. So this was a huge departure. And their friends were horrified they were doing this. But they did. They dragged their children along. And it was hard to restrain that part of the story of their travels because the photographs, the journals, it was an amazing trip.
And they went all over. They literally went all over the United States.
They made about a 3,000-mile loop, nine months, with their children, their three reluctant children on mm-hmm. a road trip.
Yeah, they looked a little reluctant.
They were so reluctant. I asked the grandson, Maud Melville's grandson, What did your mother say about this trip? What was it? Just the news? Did the family always talk about it? And he said, no, no. They didn't like the trip. They never spoke about it.
Oh.
But he and his grandmother talked about it a lot. Mm. And so that's how he ended up being the recipient of all of the papers and letters and different items that Maud bought.
Well, maybe we'll take a step backward and ask you how you came to encounter this story.
That was pretty amazing. I went to Massachusetts one time in my life, went to Sturbridge Village, and in the local newspaper was a story about this man who had grandparents who had gone on this big trip, and the front page had all these Hopi pictures.
This is just by
and
chance that
it,
you...
It was by chance, but I had been working up at Hopi,
right.
And I recognized the villages, and I was so struck that I felt this compulsion to contact. Mm-hmm. And so I found Robert Melville, and he was just wonderful from the start to have this person call up, and he invited me to his home, and he showed me letters
wonderful.
And journals, And just from the very first telephone call, he was so welcoming. And it just seemed that that summer, 2002, and it was 75 years after the Melville's trip, sort of seemed like it was meant to happen.
Yeah. Well, and your only trip to Massachusetts, you encounter this small publication that happens to have images you are familiar with, and the connection is made.
It was just astounding. No, I don't go back east. I'll go to Hopi anytime.
Well, as the Melvilles did.
Yes.
So once you have contacted the family and spent a lot of, that's how you found these archives.
Yes. I actually, Mr. Arnold copied everything for me, so I worked from the copies. But I did go to Wesleyan University. Mm-hmm. When the Melvilles went to the Hopi country, Mrs. Melville fell in love with all of the arts, and she bought everything. And her poor husband spent most of his time at Hopi getting crates and boxing things up and putting them on a wagon to send down to the railroad down in Winslow. And the family had this immense collection, big baskets and pots and rattles and kachinas, and they had them in storage for all those years. And then Robert Arnold decided that it was time to give them to a museum, so he donated them all to Wesleyan.
And these objects were the original objects that are discussed in these letters.
You see, and some of the pottery, some of the baskets are in these pictures, and it's pretty fun to, when they opened the cupboards, I recognized a Crow Mother basket, and so it was really like seeing the letters and seeing the objects.
Amazing, amazing. Now, Mr. Arnold is the grandson
of
Maud and Carrie Melville.
Yes, he's the grandson. Okay. And he was the caretaker of all of this, and he felt that it was such a valuable historic collection that he preserved it, and then he really generously shared it with me.
Yes, and let you tell this story, which I'm so glad is out for the world.
It was interesting because when he gave, there were about 140, 150 photographs. And I thought, I have the letters. I thought I'm just going to fly right through this book. Right. But I started taking these pictures up to the Hopi mesas. And I knew the villages, but I didn't know the people. And eventually, we identified all of the people. We talked to the families. Wow. And the people were so... they were so happy to see these pictures of one man in his 80s had tears in his eyes when I showed him a picture of his mother holding his brother as an infant, and he said, I never saw a picture of my mother like that. So it was wonderful. I would print all these extra copies, and I would go up, and when I found a family, I would share the pictures, and then they shared stories. And so this reciprocity.
What a wonderful exchange, pictures for stories.
Yeah.
So photographs were not part, the technology to take photographs was not part of the culture at the time in Hopi land. I mean, the tourists coming through or the voyagers coming through, whatever, they would take pictures, but then they would take the pictures away.
Yes.
And returning these images. Mm-hmm. To these people sounds like an extraordinary
Has been amazing because there were no cameras at Hopi back then, and a lot of people that went to Hopi didn't have cameras themselves, but I've written three Hopi books, and I sometimes will be contacted by a family that will say, there's a picture of our grandmother in the back row of that. Would you give us a copy? Because a lot of people have no pictures of their ancestors, particularly from the 20s and 30s. Mm-hmm. So there were, you have to understand that this was a very, very remote place in the 1920s. So
as remote as places get, really, in terms of the American landscape, this was another place altogether.
And it was remote geographically, but culturally too.
And it's so striking that Mrs. Melville would be so attracted to this, it had to be exotic to her or so different. And yet she really was...
I believe that she found this mystical connection with the Hopi Mesas. I think it changed her life. I think the rest of her years, she wrote to Ethel. She gave a lot of talks. She was very active in Indian rights associations. Mm-hmm. So I think the time that they spent there had a powerful impact on her. And the friendship that she forged with Ethel and the letters that they wrote to each other kept that connection going until the reason they stopped writing was because Ethel got trachoma and she went blind. Mm. So she could no longer write letters.
Mm. Well, the letters are an interesting thing, the physical objects, because the letters that Maud wrote to Ethel don't exist. Is that accurate?
That's correct.
Because Ethel would have had to use the paper, I would think. Anything that she had in her possession, they were using. Mm-hmm. And so those letters were somehow otherwise employed.
I think they were not saved. They weren't looked on like Mrs. Melville would have looked at the letter to put it away and save it. You have to think. The Melvilles lived in a big house. He was a professor. Mm-hmm. They had a lot of room. They had some wealth. On the other hand, Ethel lived in a tiny, tiny two-room house at just below First Mesa. Her life was so much geared to survival that saving letters was certainly not something that she was invested in doing.
Mm-hmm. And the idea that Ethel could write, a Hopi woman, 1920s, could write in English persuasively, compellingly, from the heart. This seems to me...
I believe Ethel was a very intelligent woman.
Absolutely.
From her letters, you could tell she didn't have extensive schooling, but like many Hopi children, she was probably taken away to one of the boarding schools, Keams Canyon or Tuba City or down here. Mm-hmm. Even California, the children were taken out of their homes when they were 5 and 6 years old, and many times they didn't get to go home to see their parents and for 5, 6 years.
Right.
So, but most of the Hopi people did learn English in the schools. So, even in those earlier times, they spoke English.
Mm-hmm. And those letters that Ethel wrote, they were sparse but full. They were just a few words, but they seemed to say so much.
The way she wrote, it conveyed a lot of emotion but she had a life that had a lot of tragedy and a lot of passion, and that comes through in her pretty simple words, but that comes through in her letters.
Well, let me take a moment to remind our viewers, this is Books and Company. I'm Alberto Rios, your host, and we're joined today by Carolyn O'Bagy Davis, talking about her book, Hopi Summer, Letters from Ethel to Maud, the account of two unlikely correspondents who met in the 1920s. Well, when they met each other, maybe you could, let's physically set this up, the Hopi Mesas. Did they intend to go there, the Melvilles?
Oh, well, their daughter's best friend's aunt was a missionary. Okay. Now, Mr. Melville, his intent had been to go to the Grand Canyon. That was pretty much the reason he went on this trip. But because it was not too far, he agreed that they would go up and they would visit Miss Ryan, who was a missionary, and they were going to stay a night. And their visit extended only 8 days, but that put him drastically behind on the schedule that they had planned to make the round the country trip. But they were so enchanted, and Maud was so reluctant to leave. And really the only reason that they did finally was because the rain started and they would have been marooned. There were no bridges, and as it was, when they did leave, they were stuck because the washes were full and they couldn't go any further. And they were ultimately rescued by some Navajos who used their horses to pull them through these washes. And these are big, big flooded washes, dangerous.
Right, right.
So that's why they left. I think Maud would have stayed a lot longer.
Right. Well, the way you've described it in there, it was a scary exit. I mean, they were in some peril.
Well, I can tell you, I was up by some of those washes one night when one of the ladies took me out to see her great-grandmother's sheep camp. And we got stuck, and we were out there, and it was midnight, and we had water all around us, and that dirt turns to mud. My windshield wipers were flipping mud. It's pretty harsh and remote country.
Well, harsh and remote country and harsh and remote living. I think specifically of illness. Tuberculosis in particular seems to have wreaked havoc on Hopis. And Ellen, Mrs. Mukbo, is that her name?
Mukbo.
Ethel? How do you pronounce the last name?
Mukbo.
Mukbo?
Ethel Saya. Saya Mukbo. Mukbo was her married name.
She lost her first 11 children. And not at childbirth.
That
and they were at different stages of...
They all were born healthy. 11 children were born healthy. One of the missionaries wrote to Mrs. Melville and said, Maud remains ever hopeful, and she just wanted to have a child. And because a Hopi woman has a child, because that child carries the lineage, that child becomes one of the clan members. So it's very important that a Hopi woman would have children. But to lose the children, and some of the letters that she wrote when she would have Minerva, and she watched Minerva get sick, and Clifford, he almost reached his sixth birthday. I can't even imagine living that way, knowing that one day your child could start to get sick, and then you would lose that child.
Heartbreak after heartbreak. And then to watch it in the context of her husband being sick is complicated, because we can't tell for sure if he was passing it on.
Of course, yes.
And, well, we have to think that he was.
Yes.
but her love for him was certainly not going to...
And she had quite a passionate... That was interesting that came through. She stood by him, and there were also the complications of him... Either if they followed the Jesus road, they could get help from the missionaries, but they had the pull to stay traditional, and and this pull to participate in ceremonies at a tremendous cost. When he couldn't farm and he couldn't raise sheep, it was a tremendous cost. It was survival.
Mm-hmm.
So it was a very difficult time, and Ethel was a strong lady. In a lot of ways, I think Maud saved her, because Maud could easily send things. Maud could buy some kachinas and piki and pottery, but it was a huge thing for Ethel to have a place where she could sell.
Mm-hmm.
On the other hand, Maud loved it. Maud gave her talks, and this was a wonderful thing for Maud to be able to do.
Well, it was symbiotic. Yeah. They gave something to each other.
It was, yes.
Yeah.
Someone asked me one time their sense was that it was just a one way that Ethel needed Maud to survive. I think Maud found in Ethel, she found an inspiration. She found a course for her life that was very different than it had been before she went to Hopi.
Completely different, it strikes me. And then to have somebody speaking about the Hopi on the East Coast.
Oh, yeah.
I think that had to be something. I mean.
Oh, she had little lists made. If she took some of her artifacts to a ladies' luncheon, it would be this much money if you came to her house, or if she gave a talk with slides. And she had this little business, but she was just having the best time. She loved it.
Well, she had the business, but you say somewhere in there she sent at least some of those proceeds.
Oh, of course.
Back to Ethel and to the missionaries, right?
And she was buying these things.
Yeah.
Ethel needed this outlet, because this was also the Depression.
Mm-hmm.
So the traders were not going to be buying any pottery. So it was a relationship that helped both of them so much.
Yeah. We've mentioned now the missionaries and the traders, and they are very interesting characters in this story. Good, bad, in between.
Oh.
It's a very complex situation, it strikes me. Could you talk a little bit about that? There's the one line about the missionaries, for example, as we hear about them a little later on. it says, according to the missionaries, there were two kinds of people, those who believed in God and those who believed in Satan.
Oh.
And so the traditional Hopi way
was
imperiled.
Yes. The missionaries went out with this attitude that they were bringing light to the people. They were bringing the right way. And it was very unyielding. It's not that way today. Mm-hmm. And there's a more of a coexistence between traditionals and Christian Hopis. Mm-hmm. At the time, there were really unfortunate things going on because the missionaries insisted, if you are baptized, you must renounce everything. Mm-hmm. And that meant you lost your home. You couldn't live on the mesa. You had to go down below and live with the dead. That's where they buried mm-hmm. people. So you lost your culture. You lost your fields. It was a huge choice for the people that made that choice. Mm-hmm. So it was a difficult thing. And yet, at that time, the missionaries often represented survival,
sure,
particularly for Ethel. Mm-hmm. It was survival.
Well, there were some acts of let's call this grace. I don't mean that in a religious way necessarily. In that there was some food and gift distribution for different events, Christmas, let's say, mm-hmm. Whether or not you were converted. Now, these were attempts mm-hmm. to convert, but there was some.
Yeah.
Some.
Well, they would have the big Christmas parties, and everybody went because there were gifts and there was food and feasting. Mm-hmm. The missionaries had the best intentions. They truly mm-hmm. believed they were doing good. Mm-hmm. Looking back, we see it from a different perspective. We mm-hmm. we now look on the loss of culture and mm-hmm. you know, perhaps that is a little unfortunate, but the missionaries were incredibly dedicated people. Mm-hmm. They were sent there, and the women were sent to the American Indian reservations. Men got to go to the exotic places like Africa, but women on the reservations had they about starved along with everybody.
Well, they were giving their lives and their health.
And
they had to periodically take sort of sabbaticals from this work because they were getting this tuberculosis as well.
It was a very hard life. It was a hard time. There was no help. There were few stores. It was a pretty rugged mm-hmm. existence. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And what about the traders? There's one trader in particular who seemed to be an outlet for Ethel's pottery.
Well, Tom Pavaccio was a Hopi. And that was kind of unusual.
Yeah.
He was a very successful Hopi trader. He had a trading post at the bottom of First Mesa. So people trusted him, and he did a lot. And he went between those two worlds of the traditional Hopis and the missionaries, and he also interfaced with the larger world, with the Bahanas in the big cities. So he was an unusual man that he could navigate all through there.
But you use the word Bahanas. That's outsiders, is that?
It's white people.
White people, okay.
Yeah, I'm nice. A Bahana.
You're, okay. Well, you know, in terms of the, we're talking about these articles of art that she's constructing, and their culture as well. They're cultural things. It was hard to read about them making things and then having to give them up. That was one thing, but they were also surviving, and you it's clear that was the first priority.
Was to survive.
Right. Mm-hmm. But the great irony that it cost more to ship things than to buy them, to purchase them, is a hard thing to read.
Yes.
It's hard to know where to place the value there, uh-huh. you know?
Oh, even one time Ethel wrote that she had made some things, but she didn't have any money to mm-hmm. ship. You know, Ethel had no money. Well, people on the reservation had no
It was
cash.
A barter system, as uh-huh. you've explained in there,
yeah.
much more so. And mm-hmm. and so money was a curious thing. And you talk about the tin money that the traders would give. So,
yeah,
so
cash was pretty rare up there. But as far as the arts, I think that even today the arts are very important for support and mm-hmm. and. The trade in art, in baskets and pottery, kachinas, is very important to the people that live traditional, because the Hopi reservation is a long way from any city, a long way from jobs, mm-hmm. and they are quite dependent on the people coming to purchase their arts.
It's a way of sharing culture.
Oh, it is, absolutely.
Well, thank you, Carolyn. We've been talking today with Carolyn O'Bagy Davis about her book, Hopi Summer, Letters from Ethel to Maud. It's a wonderful book.
Yeah.
I'm Alberto Rios for Books and Company. Thank you for joining us today, and we hope to see you again very soon when we bring you another good book.
Books and Company is made possible by the Virginia G. Piper Center for Creative Writing, serving writers and readers in the Phoenix metropolitan area and throughout Arizona.